75 car ran in the back of him, and that doesn't surprise me because I thought in practice yesterday that he was going to crash. So it doesn't surprise me that he caused a wreck like this.
I'm John Kernan. Coming up on RPM tonight, the professor of motorsports, Benny Parsons, will be here to look back at the weekend's action at Talladega, and we'll also check out testing at the Richmond International Raceway. But first, the Diehard 500 Sunday at the Talladega Super Speedway provided just about everything a race fan could want. The big crash, in which a lot of cars took wild rides, but all the drivers walked away unhurt. A lot of lead changes, and a win by a living legend whose moves on the track could be followed by watching the fans sitting or standing in the stands. And there were some other stories that Bill Weber says will have people talking for a while.
Every Talladega race is a memorable one. The only difference is why. Sunday, trouble started before the race did as smoke billowed from Jeff Burton's Ford on the warm-up laps. The points leader was forced to pit. And since the crew couldn't pinpoint the problem, there was certainly no way to solve it. Except maybe hope.
There seems to be oil getting in the tailpipe. Don't think it's a loose line. Seems like it might be a hole in a pushrod tube for the intake port or something. I doubt if it's anything we can fix. It might run all day. We'll see.
Got to have a little bit of luck. We're not too disappointed with this finish. We're not overly joyed. We finished, and we haven't been finishing these restricted plate races, and almost the top 10. And when you come out of these plate races and aren't tore up, then you don't get hurt too bad.
Fans crave the close quarters of restricted plate racing. Drivers dread it. The plate tracks have earned their reputation as the place where the big one happens, and Sunday it did again. On lap 49, inexperience, impatience, and perhaps ego and excitement all contributed to it. Mike Skinner and Tony Stewart started it. Several pre-race favorites were finished by it.
That was one of the stupidest things I've seen since I've been racing. You're not even to your first pit stop yet. They talk to these guys till they're blue in the face. At the driver's meeting, everybody saw what happened yesterday, and you got two guys stubborn enough before the first pit stop over one spot to take cars down in the grass and wreck cars. I don't even know how many cars got wrecked. Hope nobody got hurt, but you would think to get the Winston Cup, you'd have better sense than that.
When you say you're not happy with Mike, can you explain that, Larry?
Well, I just think it was awfully early in the race for what was going on over there on the backstretch to be going on. And again, I'm not blaming anybody. I'll walk off the side of a mountain for the driver I work for, but I'll also put him in his place when he's wrong. And he's like the kid that's in trouble. He better hope this race lasts a long time because I'm going to get him when it's over with.
I know Tony didn't do anything deliberately. We saw him racing, and I just see him coming down, and 31 was just crowding him. We got in the grass. I mean, what are you going to do there? I mean, why was he coming down? I don't know. I mean, it's racing. It's what this place is all about.
You got guys getting three wide and things, and you're watching your mirror trying to make sure that nobody gets inside or outside of you. And I'm sure that's what happened with those guys. They got to kind of blocking each other and got into one another and got down the grass.
Maybe the 20 should have got out of gas or the 31 shouldn't have done that, but it was really both their faults. And that caused a big wreck. But you can't say anything bad about anybody, really. It's just restricted plate racing. But when a problem does happen and you see who causes it, you wish that character wouldn't have caused it.
The big one sidelined several contenders and helped clear a path for the Goodwin Chevy. Dale Earnhardt, who hadn't led a lap all season, led the most laps on Sunday with another strong restrictor plate car. Second at Daytona, first most of this day, he worked traffic, dodged trouble, avoided disaster when a left front wheel tried to work its way loose, and drove to his eighth win at Talladega.
Well, the car was good all day. We just wanted to be in position, and we kept working after that pit stop. We'd gotten behind a little bit because we hadn't checked the left front out. I had a vibration come in the car, and so we checked it out. I got behind a bit, but worked my way back up, and thought Mark, when he got to Jarrett, that it would help Jarrett maybe get by me, but they couldn't mount a charge there the last lap.
Dale Earnhardt now has 72 NASCAR Winston Cup wins, and most fans can recall every one of them. But when this season comes to a close, this race might be remembered for a guy that didn't even finish in the top 10. He qualified third, started 43rd, and finished 11th. Winston Cup points leader, Jeff Burton. In Talladega, I'm Bill Weber, ESPN.
Benny Parsons joins us now. Benny, whenever I talked to Jeff Gordon after the big wreck, he alluded to the fact that he wasn't having the type of luck this year that he has had in the past, while at the same time, it looks like Jeff Burton might be having that kind of a year. Does it look like this could be Burton's year?
It really could be Jeff Burton's year. There's no doubt, because he is having some good luck. Yesterday, it looked like it was all over for Jeff Burton because of the smoke. He ran 500 miles, completed all 500 miles on the lead lap.
What exactly happened to Burton's car to make it smoke like that?
I'm told that when they grind the cylinder heads to make the horsepower, they sometimes get too close and they go through. So they put epoxy over that hole to fill up the hole so that it doesn't suck oil. Well, on the low RPMs, the oil pump doesn't keep up. Oil pools up in the engine. Mm-hmm. It would seep into that hole where the epoxy fell out. Once he hits the accelerator, once he starts racing and he turns the engine 7,000 RPMs, then the oil pump sucks all the oil that's in the engine out of the engine into the reservoir in the back, so there is no oil there to seep into the engine.
And it was an internal leak, so it wasn't like they were getting air from the outside, too, right?
No, it was inside the engine, so there was no fresh air getting in to make the car run faster.
Now, what about Gordon and company? Matt Yocum told me that in interviewing Ray Evernham, that he said basically their championship hopes are over. They're 210 points back. Ray.
Ray, 210 back? We've only, what, 9 races we've run so far? We've got 25 to go. Ray, remember Dover, Delaware, 1992, Alan Kowicki, 278 back with about 6 or 7 races to go. Right, it's not over yet.
But you know, Biddy, that's 9 races. That's 3 finishes of 38th or worse. It's not like it was, so I guess their good luck finally is normal?
Yeah, it's normal. Okay. Exactly. There's a thing in this world called law of averages. Baseball players are not going to hit 500. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, Ted Williams was the last guy to hit 400. That was in 1941. So in auto racing, if you run the NASCAR Winston Cup 500 laps, 500 miles, you're going to blow engines, you're going to have flat tires, and people are going to run into you, and you're going to run into people. That's going to happen. And for 3 years, it hasn't happened to Jeff Gordon in a normal way. I mean, he hasn't blown a lot of engines. He hasn't had a lot of flat tires. He hasn't hit a lot of things. So all of a sudden now, the law of averages has got to catch up, and they're catching up pretty fast.
It sure looks like it. Saturday, Dale Earnhardt, law of averages, put him out on a restrictor plate track or something like Talladega or Daytona. He's going to win. He pulled off a great move on Rusty Wallace to win the IROC race on Saturday. Then Sunday, he's out front late. Dale Jarrett's behind him. Why couldn't Jarrett come up and do the bump and run like Earnhardt did to Rusty?
Well, you know, I think that Jarrett talked in his interview like he backed up so he and Mark Martin could get a run on Earnhardt. He said, but Earnhardt sensed that he was backing up, so he backed up to them to keep them from getting a run. Earnhardt just seems to have a sense of what it takes to win at Talladega. I just wish I had talked to Dale Earnhardt a long time ago when I first started running in Talladega. I said, Dale, you know, help me out here, man. What do you need to do
here?
Wait
a minute. When you first started running in Talladega, Dale Earnhardt was running on the short tracks around, right?
So he should have been talking to me, right? He should have been talking
yeah,
to me.
Exactly.
But instead, I just never sensed what it took to win at Talladega, Daytona, those restricted plate racetracks. But Earnhardt has just that feel of what he needs to do to win.
I swear, I think that he can move his car and slow the guys behind him down. I swear, it looks that way. Benny, stick around, because when RPM Tonight continues, we're going to talk to BP about the big wreck Sunday at Talladega. And later on the show, all the hot action in this week's Speed Shot. A lot of people have said to me that Sunday's big wreck at Talladega wasn't really that big because it didn't involve at least a third of the field. Don't try telling that to the teams who saw their cars get torn up because of someone else's mistake. It was big to them. But while some of those teams might still be mad at Mike Skinner and Tony Stewart, those two drivers have already made their peace.
Stewart and Skinner almost get it together. They're in the grass. On here goes Skinner, crossing in front of all these cars.
Chad Little, Jeremy Rusty Wallace.
they said Tony's got a run on you, and I was guarding the bottom, and I just kept coming down, and I didn't think he was far enough along there, and just, you know, it's hard to see out that side of the car, and we just barely touched, and at that point, you know, it's pretty hard, you know, it's pretty hard to save a race car right there, and it's probably as much my fault as it is anybody's, because it's awful early in the race, and trying to guard that top spot right there was kind of stupid, you know. I'd rather went back to 20th and come back if we had a good race car, but like I told everybody from the jump street, you know, Tony's a good race driver, and, you know, maybe he should have backed out. Maybe I should have realized that maybe I shouldn't have kept coming down, you know. I'm not mad at nobody, and I don't really blame myself, and I don't really blame Tony. It was a racing deal.
I think we're probably going to team up, and we're going to open up our own lawn cutting service, because we mowed a lot of Talladega grass today. But just like you said, I mean, I probably should have backed down, and I was afraid that if I backed out, there was a whole line of cars that gave me a push right there that were going to go by both of us. But, you know, the only way to get the experience is to go out here and do what we're doing, and, you know, that's part of being a rookie. I'm going to make mistakes, too, and but, I mean, don't let this guy fool you. I mean, he's been one of the guys that when I've been down and struggling at places, he's been one of the first guys that's come over to help me. So, you know, that's why we're able to stand here and smile at each other.
It's easy to sit here right now, and me as being here for a couple of years, and say, he knew better than to keep going down there, and it's easy to say he knows better than to stay in that gas. We both made a little bit of a mistake there, and it's just one of those situations, and they asked me if I was mad at Tony Stewart, and I said, I remember a guy named Mike Skinner made a lot of mistakes his rookie year. That's the worst one Tony makes. He's going to do good.
Hey, we heard Larry McReynolds was a little miffed. Are you hiding from Larry?
Nah, if he's mad at me, he'll get over it. He just, you know, Larry and I got a great relationship, but I got to go get my rear end chewed out right now, matter of fact, so thanks, guys.
Well, Benny, we've heard from all the parties involved. I want to take one more look at it. We've heard what they say is going on. Are you thinking about it as you're driving down the backstretch at Talladega when all this is going on?
I guess Mike Skinner probably was looking in the mirror, trying to see where Tony Stewart was and could he want to keep in front of him. And all of a sudden he looked up, and there was the grass in front of him. And about the time Skinner got to the grass, it looked like he and Stewart made contact, which kind of forced his car. He had to turn the steering wheel, which he got in the grass and lost control. Tony Stewart drove through the grass and never lost control. But Mike Skinner, just that little bit of touch from Stewart, gets him going, and back across the racetrack he goes and leaves the other guys with very few options.
And Jeff Gordon came within about 2 inches of making it through there. In fact, he might have overcorrected too.
Very possibly.
I mean, we get a look from up top, and I thought, you know, you see there was... Now, did Skinner just turn the wheel maybe too much, or was that little bump from Tony enough to get him out of shape? And here comes Gordon.
That little bump from Stewart is what got him out of shape, which caused him to have to turn the steering wheel.
And then once you turn the steering wheel on the grass?
You're off. Because it rained Saturday night, a lot of rain Saturday night. That was very muddy down there. It's, you know, grass has no traction even when it's dry, but certainly no traction when it's wet.
Now, aside from the big wreck, Ken Schrader started from the pole, survived that, appeared to be in a position to win until late in the race, developed a clutch problem. What problems are we talking about here?
Well, these cars use an hydraulic clutch, and when they press the accelerator, the fluid is making the throwout bearing push against the pressure plate and make the clutch work. Well, somehow the fluid wouldn't work. It was building up pressure inside the line, and the throwout bearing was pressing against the pressure plate and releasing the clutch, making it slip. And they could not get the hydraulic system to release the throwout bearing. So finally they got raised the hood, cracked the valve, which released the fluid and the pressure against the throwout bearing, and that got the throwout bearing away from the pressure plate, and then he had a clutch. The only problem, he didn't have a clutch to shift with or to take off. We saw him in the pits start, turn the engine off, put it in gear, start the engine, and go start that way. Now, the transmission he was using, he did not require a clutch to shift on restart, so that was no problem.
Now, when you say it was slipping, that means that as he was trying to accelerate, the power wasn't getting to the rear wheel?
That's right. He would accelerate the engine, but the power would not go through the drive shaft back to the rear wheels. It just, the engine would rev and not go anyplace.
Terry Labonte had a rearing and gear brake on him, but it wasn't like he did it leaving the pits. He was out there running at speed. How's that happen?
That, John, is what's called bad luck. Uh-huh. You know, I don't really believe a lot in bad luck, but at Talladega with 450 horsepower, a 2.5-mile racetrack, when you break a rear gear, that's nothing but bad luck.
What about Steve Park? They broke a gear in the distributor, and then also, what, a rocker arm for David Green. And like you say, they're not turning the engines that much.
Well, I think what happened to Steve Park, he overshot his pits. and he was trying to back up to get into his pit stall, and I think while the car was still rolling forward, he put it in reverse and let the clutch out, which stopped the engine immediately, and the gear on the distributor slides up on the distributor's shaft. There's a pin that goes through that holds the gear in place. It sheared that pin off.
Wow. And then the rocker arm, just one of those things.
Well, on the restrictor plate engines, they use a camshaft that is so radical in trying to get air and fuel mixture inside the engine, they really take that valve up and then hold it and then drop it real fast. It's awfully hard on the valve train.
All right, Benny, stick around. Next on RPM Tonight, all the thrilling action of the weekend. Speed Shots coming your way next.
Speed Shots is brought to you by Quaker State for protection beyond 3,000 miles. Under any driving conditions.
Three wide through the third quarter. Three abreast of just side by side.
Next on RPM Tonight, we'll talk to Benny about Saturday's close finish in the Busch Series race.
The Slim Jim team is going to go to victory lane.
Wow. How about that?
There's no words to describe that. I mean, 5 years from now, we'll pick up a record book and say Terry Labonte won the Busch race at Talladega. It will not be a mention. Joe Nemechek will simply be the fellow who finished second. I mean, 2,000th of a second. Folks, it must have been that much that Nemechek was beaten by, but in 5 years, no one will know that. That's a shame.
You ever been involved in a finish somewhat similar to that?
No, I could never get that close.
So what do you think it would be like? You're Joe Nemechek. You think in that car you've won the race. Your crew's celebrating. Then you get down and somebody tells you, no, you finished second.
By that much.
But, you know, the strange thing is our score monitor in the booth, it first showed the 44 car. And I really, folks, I haven't seen the photograph that tells me who won the race. But our score monitor said 44. I said, well, Labonte must have beaten him. And then all of a sudden I look up, it says 87. I said, well, someone has manually changed it back to Nemechek. So the NASCAR booth is next door to ours, so I kept looking over, who won? And finally, Mike Helton said 44. And then I looked up on the monitor and they changed it back to 44.
Yeah, can you imagine if he had tried to do 87? A little bit tough. Randy LaJoie had perhaps the strongest car. Not to say that the reason they did it is because it's easier to show 44 to Benny, but Randy LaJoie had perhaps the strongest car in the field. And then I guess it was after the big wreck on that caution coming in. Ed Barrier was turning into the garage. Randy hit him, messed up his car. I was standing right there. I almost leaned out to wave at Randy to stop, slow down. This is going to hurt. The Barrier wasn't making any hand signals. Should he have been?
Well, yeah, he probably should have been. But after all, his day is over. He's not going to win the 300-mile Busch race at Talladega. He's crushed. He's not thinking about looking in the mirror or anything else. All he's thinking about is getting his car to the garage area and loading up and going home. And what in the world? How in the world that happened is beyond me, but it sure ruined LaJoie's day because he made enough damage to the right front fender that the car just never handled like it did originally.
Now, they taped it up, and at one point he worked his way, I think, up to the third or fourth, and then he dropped back. What kind of problems, handling problems, are we talking about with that kind of damage?
Well, John, you know, they spend a lot of time on those fenders, molding those fenders to make them exactly what they want. They go to the wind tunnel and blow air across that to get exactly the same, the right shape that they want. Well, you know, they can't, with duct tape, 200-mile-per-hour duct tape, put that tape on there and come up with the same shape that they had originally or the same shape that they're looking for. All they're trying to do is just get the car back on the racetrack as best they can, and obviously it was not quite good enough.
Mm. Hey, he had a strong car, though, man.
Benny, thanks a lot. We'll talk to you soon.
All right, John.
Coming up on RPM tonight, we're going to check out testing at the Richmond International Raceway.